Okay, it's a great pleasure for me and honor to be here with Juan Maldacena in conversations about physics and how to do physics and about the ICTP. So Juan Maldacena is giving the Salam Distinguished Lectures here at the International Center for Theoretical Physics. We are in fact at the moment sitting in the Salam's office, former office. And he has been telling us about connections between quantum mechanics and space-time and very exciting developments at the very frontiers of physics. He is a professor at the Institute for Advanced Study in Princeton and is widely regarded as one of the leading physicists of his generation, and he has made pioneering and very original contributions to several aspects of quantum gravity and cosmology and string theory. And perhaps his most influential work is what is known as the ADS-CFT holographic correspondence, which has been a very active field of research for the last 20 years or so. So maybe let me start my questions starting with the ADS-CFT correspondence. So at some level, it's I think for all the practitioners in this field, it's clearly something very deep that we have uncovered about an equivalence, quantum equivalence between a theory of gravity and the theory without gravity. But sometimes I get a feeling that even our colleagues in the very nearby fields don't fully appreciate how remarkable is this equivalence, and even more so for a common person on the street. So maybe can you try to bring out what you think are the most, a bit about the ADS-CFT correspondence?
Yeah, so this is a relationship between a theory of interacting particles and a theory of gravity. And it has a few interesting aspects. So one of them is that the theory of gravity seems to live in more dimensions than the theory of interacting particles. So somehow it looks as if one of the dimensions of space-time arises in an emergent way. So emergent is like in some approximate way or some way that was not manifest in the original description. And this also has enabled us to understand aspects of black holes, because you can have a black hole in the interior and it's described by a thermal system or some system in the boundary theory. And then this leads to a description which is fully consistent with the laws of quantum physics, because it's embedding the black hole in ordinary theory of quantum physics. But also it seems to give a interesting picture for what space-time is. So it looks like the degrees of freedom that describe space-time do not live, there are no atoms for space-times that live, you know, locally in space, but they live at the boundary far away. And well, this is some aspect of quantum gravity. I think we are yet to discover the true lessons of this for cosmology, for example, and for the Big Bang singularity and so on, that they probably will have some lessons, or maybe it's even weirder than than this idea CFT, where, so in this correspondence, the direction that is emergent is the radial direction, so it's a space-like direction. In cosmology, we expect that perhaps the emergent direction is the time direction, so there might be some description perhaps without time, and then yeah, well, now I'm speculating about the applications to cosmology.
Okay, we'll come to that. It's a very interesting question.
Yeah, but even without speculation, so we come with this to this realization by thinking about objects in string theory, these D-brains, so-called D-brains, which are some type of soliton or some solutions of string theory that have a very precise description. Found by Polchinski, and using them, and also the relationship between them and solutions of gravity, black brains, and black holes, one was led to this correspondence. But we still don't fully understand how it works. So we think it's true, and we can check some of the consequences of the relationship. some detailed mathematical formulas. So if the relationship is true, then you derive that certain mathematical equalities should hold, and they do hold. But in general, the relationship relates strongly interacting systems of quantum particles to some gravitational systems, some, let's say, Einstein gravity systems. But one of the issues is that it's very hard to study these interacting systems of quantum particles, so it's hard to find an explicit correspondence or the explicit map between the two variables. So in physics, sometimes we have different descriptions of the same phenomenon. So, I mean, a very simple case is that if we have a signal that varies in time, we can give the signal as how it changes in time, or we can give all its frequency components, for example. And those two descriptions of the signal are equivalent, and this is an equivalence we understand in great detail, and we understand completely explicitly. But in this other case, we don't have such an explicit understanding. That would be the one of the goals would be to have an explicit understanding or mapping between the two types of variables, the variables we use to describe space-time, like metrics and the geometry of space-time, and the variables we use to describe the quantum systems, the quantum mechanical system. So.
Yeah, so I think your work has influenced the work of many of us in the field. Last year in Princeton, there was this 20 years of ADS-CFT, and it was still, I mean, all the talks there were still, it doesn't look like this idea has run out of steam. So if you look at this last 20 years, what development has sort of surprised you the most in the ADS-CFT correspondence?
Well, there were many interesting surprises. There were surprises for me in terms of applications. Perhaps the application to condensed matter is, for me, was the most surprising. I thought that, I don't know, the systems are very different, but nevertheless, there were interesting lessons for condensed matter, and vice versa, the condensed matter physicists have given us also interesting perspectives. In terms of, let's say, more formal developments, I think this connection between entanglement and geometry, perhaps the best example is there is a formula that Rue and Takayanagi derived for computing the entanglement entropy of a region. That is a kind of generalization of the famous Hawking-Bekenstein formula, which computes the entropy of a black hole. And so, yeah, I think those are, yeah, that was an interesting development that has led to, again, more surprising connections. So the idea that entanglement is fundamental for determining the structure of space-time, that you can have connected space-times even though the Hamiltonian or the interactions are not, though the two systems are not connected. So somehow space-time seems to capture the correlations present in the quantum state. So it's a way to describe the correlations present in the wave function.
Yes, so actually that brings me to a question that also I have asked myself sometimes. That so at some level, ADS-CFT correspondence seems to teach us something about quantum gravity, mm-hmm. about black holes and mm-hmm. so on. Mm-hmm. But there is another point of view that maybe ADS-CFT is just a kind of a framework mm-hmm. for studying it's not like the gravity is just some kind of effective description.
Right.
And how do you view, what is your take on this? Do you view ADS-CFT as something deep about gravity, or do you regard this as a kind of a framework for where gravity emerges as just an effective description?
I think the question is whether gravity is a bit like hydrodynamics. So hydrodynamics is a theory that we use to describe fluids, but hydrodynamics is not the most basic description of the system. So we have some interacting particles that interact with the laws of quantum mechanics or classical physics or whatever. And then at long distances or for insufficient in certain circumstances, we can also have a hydrodynamic description. The hydrodynamic description is in some sense approximate. It can fail sometimes. You can form shock waves. You can perhaps have some singularity. So. And we are not surprised by this. And it's also a description where we lose information, where entropy can increase and so on. Now, one perspective is that, well, maybe gravity is something similar. So gravity is an effective description of the quantum system, and it will be approximate, and well, it breaks down sometimes, and well, it might be then replaced by something else, and the something else that replaces is the quantum system. So you have to go back to the quantum system. So that's a perspective that is actually quite popular, and some people think about it this way. Even if you accept this perspective, it's a kind of effective description that gives more information about the entanglement of the system and even microscopic aspects of the entanglement. So, for example, we just discussed this Ruta-Kayanagi formula. This formula is not computing the entropy of the system, the usual entropy of the system. It's computing the microscopic entropy of the system, the so-called fine-grained entropy. And so that, to me, tells me that the gravity knows more, is keeping some very detailed information. Now you can say, well, okay, yeah, it's keeping this detailed information, but only the total value. It doesn't know about the particular microstate. So you could also say that. But well, it's a little more than hydrodynamics, at least in that sense. And I think the original idea was that it was a true duality, that there were two possible descriptions. One was the gravitational description, and certainly string theory gives us a full perturbative description that makes sense, and we think that even non-perturbatively we can define this theory, and for some observables, like some very supersymmetric observables, you can actually do the full computation and sum this perturbation series. So that was always viewed as the evidence that there is a theory of gravity that is independently defined. It could be defined by string theory, for example. I'm inclined to view this this second option. I think gravity is too beautiful and too interesting to be just an effective theory.
Okay, good. I'm glad that you can.
I suspect that maybe once, well, this is now speculation. Well, the previous statement was also speculation. Yes. That once we understand gravity well enough, actually the quantum system will be immersion. will appear when we cut the gravity description into two pieces. So we introduce some boundaries and we separate the full gravity solution into a piece that we want to describe, and the rest that we view as measuring or some classical aspect, this classical, let's say, measurement apparatus that is measuring the.
I see. That's an interesting point of view. Uh-huh. That entanglement, somehow you break the entanglement and then.
Yes.
Okay. So, we'll come back to science, but before that, I also wanted to ask you a bit about. So, ICTP has this other important aspect to its mission. Mm-hmm. That, on one hand, we have excellence in science,
right.
And on the other hand, we have inclusion. People who are normally left out of the scientific enterprise. And that was certainly the guiding principle for Salam. And you yourself come from Argentina. You have did your early work in Argentina. Yeah. Then you went to Princeton. Mm-hmm. So, and I know that you are also a frequent visitor. I think I remember also giving lectures with you a long time ago. You have been here maybe, 20 times, mm-hmm. 10 times.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And you are the member of our scientific council, so you have sort of seen ICTP is functioning. So do you?
Well, I think ICTP plays a real singular role in connecting science to the countries, in the old days they were called third world countries.
That is
Let's say least developed countries.
Developing countries.
Indeed, it had an important role to play. Well, in Argentina, it was pretty important for scientists to connect to the developments in the latest developments in science. So, for example, my former advisor in Argentina. He did his PhD in Argentina on some aspects of statistical mechanics, and then he came here to the ICTP to do a postdoc. And at the time, everyone here in the ICTP was very excited about string theory. It was one of the main, well, it was after 1984 with all these developments. And so he came here and everyone was doing string theory. So, well, he joined. And if he wanted to talk to everyone, anyone, he had to do string theory. And well, he learned string theory here. He did some work on those well, string theory subjects here. Then he went back to Argentina and started a group doing string theory. And well, I joined them and I during my, let's say, master thesis or early bachelor's thesis and so on. So, yeah, and that was very useful for me and also for other people in Argentina. Another example is Horacio Cassini. So he also had a similar story. He did his work on particle physics in Argentina. Then he came here to the ICTP. He started, I think, here working on entanglement in quantum field theory. Then he went back to Argentina and continued working for this field for in this field for a long time. And not many people were paying attention to this field. And he and also Marina Huerta. They both came here and went back to Argentina, and they obtained really beautiful results using these methods that reveal us deep truths about quantum field theory. So basically what they did was to show that there are certain quantities related to entanglement. Basically entanglement entropies are monotonic when you sort of decrease when you go in the RG flow direction. So when you coarse grain a theory. And people, this was kind of a holy grail in quantum field theory, was to find quantities that decrease when you follow the renormalization from. Yeah, that's right. So in two dimensions, it was known that it was true, and they found the proof of this in three dimensions. They also proved all the results in two dimensions using these techniques, and also in four dimensions, which also had previously been shown using other techniques. So like, they had a unified description of all dimensions.
Yes.
Using all these techniques. And well, they found also many other things, interesting things related to entanglement. They also created a group in
Huerta lectured last spring school here.
And you see that it comes back to here, to the ICTP.
That's right.
And
So these are actually two really very important sort of success stories. I mean, in indirect ways, just guiding somebody in the right direction or sending people in the more exciting directions of science has this big effect on...
Right. I mean, the one of the ideas of ICTP was to be a place where scientists from developing countries can meet. And one of the difficulties of doing science in the developing countries is the lack of connections and the lack of... the lack of communication. So of course now with the internet you can you can see people's papers and so on, but there isn't a face-to-face contact.
Right.
And,
what is exciting?
What is exciting, and the news and all that. And one of the ideas of ICTP was to serve as a place where this could happen, and I think it's working.
If it has led to ADS-CFT correspondence, that's a big success. So this is certainly one very important aspect of ICTP's mission. But okay, now as a leader in this field and also being, for example, an advisor to the ICTP, what areas of, I mean, where do you think ICTP is doing a very good job, and or where we could improve? Do you have any thoughts on that?
I think the schools are an important part. The associates programs is also an important part, I think.
What is most effective?
I think those are very, very effective programs, and I think they.
People here and.
Bring people here, make them, talk to each other, interact with the faculty here, interact with other visitors that come for schools. So, being a meeting place.
As a meeting place. I think that was actually his original Yeah, and yeah. I think because it's a question to be asked, because you know, in 50 years things have changed, as you said. Mm-hmm. Countries which were regarded as third world are now in a different bracket. You know, India and China are, or BRIC countries are in a different bracket. So one needs to rethink about how to reorient ICTP's mission a little bit. But you say that some of these aspects still remain true today, and and maybe we can do things different. Maybe we can get money to try to persuade. For example, one in this initiative in Brazil. I mean, do you think that's one way to spread our mission? Or
yeah, so that's another thing that the ICTP was doing, is to create sort of daughter or centers. So the use the expertise that has been built here, building an international institution, and to create other more local, regional, international centers. For example, I've been involved with one in Brazil. There is also a similar one there that was started later in Argentina. Of creating a place where, again, would be a place for people to meet within the country and perhaps with neighboring countries, perhaps bringing scientists from abroad. So a center that would work well with international standards, and the ICTP can guide them to do this, can oversee it. And, so and, it's working, it's developing, and I think the ICTP has done this in various places of the world. I'm only involved in these two places.
Yes. Also, we have in now we have one in Beijing. And Okay. So maybe coming back to science, when you you briefly mentioned, I mean, clearly one of the very exciting scientific developments has to do with cosmology, and anti-de Sitter space, that where the ADS-CFT correspondence comes, and the de Sitter space in which we seem to be living in. They're kind of closely related, but at the same time, they're very far from each other.
Yeah,
and
so
one has thought about this.
One has somehow positive, what we call positive curvature, and the other one has negative curvature. So we got the sign wrong.
We got the sign wrong, yes.
Well, you say, why do you study this one? If we live in a positive space with positive curvature, why do we study the one with negative curvature? And the reason is that for the one with negative curvature, we understand more. And in physics, sometimes it's easier to, well, it's useful to study a case where at least you can say something and then get some intuition. Perhaps we can say something also for the case with positive curvature. In many ways, they are not too different. I mean, in fact, if you do calculations purely in gravity, you can translate between the calculations done in both cases, just at the level of solving the classical equations and so on. If you solve the classical equations with negative curvature, you can immediately get the solution.
Flip the sign.
Yeah, you flip the sign. You don't have to resolve the equation. Same solutions can apply for the other case. And indeed, this has led to some interesting ways of thinking about cosmological correlators and cosmological observables that are computed in inflation. So the period of inflation is the period where the universe was well approximated by the Sitter space. And yeah, so, but we don't have clear examples of of a full duality where you have the full quantum system for a system that is dual to Einstein gravity. There are some examples for systems that are related to higher spin gravity, so some other kind of theory of gravity, sometimes called also Vassiliev gravity, where you don't only have the graviton, but you have an infinite number of particles with higher spins. Mm-hmm. So, maybe.
Yeah, and certainly, I guess this exploration of non-Gaussianities in cosmology was kind of inspired by, you could say, by analogies with ADS-CFT.
That's right.
But okay, so, but one has not had something as concrete as the ADS-CFT correspondence for cosmology.
That's right. Yeah, the non-Gaussianities are so you have the primordial fluctuations that have been studied using, they are imprinted in the cosmic microwave background and are very close to Gaussian. But non-Gaussianities, so small statistical deviations from, let's say, the bell curve, have the potential to teach us something about the interactions that were present during inflation. And yeah, this is an this was an active field. I mean, people are looking for these non-Gaussianities. They've been looking for these non-Gaussianities for a long time, and yeah, and hopefully with the newer experiments, we'll have the statistical power to see these tiny non-Gaussianities. So what we know is now is that, well, the non-Gaussianities are not big, they're very small. But hopefully we'll see them at some point and teach us something new about the very early universe. I mean, this is the best probe that we have of the very early universe, and we can think of this as a kind of cosmological accelerator, if you wish, or microscope. That is allowing us to look at the universe when it was very small, and
the highest
energies that could be accessible by observations, and so roughly speaking, the non-Gaussianities tell us about the particle collisions that occurred in the very early universe. So there were particles or waves in the very early universe, and their collisions produce some non-linearities, and there's this non-Gaussian. That they get translated in our present observations as these deviations, statistical deviations from Gaussianity.
Mm-hmm. I have another question about sort of, maybe it's a bit about sociology of science. Mm-hmm. So in the past, there was kind of a much more direct link between theory and observation, meaning mm-hmm. whatever you imagine, you could more or less mm-hmm. imagine doing an experiment in 2 years' time. Or oftentimes the data was ahead of the theory and mm-hmm. it prompted. Mm-hmm. We are somehow in a kind of a peculiar historical situation where our theories are extremely powerful and their structure is so rigid that mm-hmm. we have great confidence. For example, the Higgs boson is an example where mm-hmm. more or less all physicists were convinced that spontaneous symmetry broken gauge theories is the right framework. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay, how the details will work out, there were electroweak unification, Salam himself was responsible for it. But it took 50 years and billions of dollars and thousands of physicists working on it. So there is clearly some additional criteria of logical consistency and which is as important as verification. I mean, even before it want to think about verifying it with an experiment.
Right.
So that seems to guide the research, and it's even more true in string theory. So do you want to sort of comment on this, that how does one, in a world where we don't have immediate contact with experiment, how does a physicist choose good problems or
Right. Directions? So as you said, the electroweak theory was an example where people could have some idea of how physics could be at the distances much shorter than the ones they could measure at the time. And indeed, it took many years to get to those shorter distances. String theory or quantum gravity involves a jump in distances, which is much bigger.
Much bigger.
So it's like roughly the jump in distances between our scale and the scales that the LHC can probe today.
Right.
So if we shrank to those scales, then quantum gravity would we have to build another LHC.
LHC squared.
Yeah, that's right. But. So you might think, well, many things could happen, and indeed, many things would happen. But we think that the framework we could use through all those scales is the framework of quantum field theory, and that framework would have to be changed when we get to gravity, and that I think we know, and string theory is a theory that for how this framework could be changed. And I think that it's very difficult to put together quantum mechanics and gravity, the fact that string theory managed to do it says that, well, this is only an interesting example at least to study, and that it's a problem that looks so constrained that it might have a unique solution
much like in the case of quantum gauge theory, and spontaneous broken gauge theory was basically the only way you could.
Or at least we might have a unique framework, or maybe the framework is more general than string theory. Mm-hmm. Maybe it's not the current understanding of string theory, but it tells us that string theory is only an interesting example or a toy model to study, or at the very least, it's that. And it might be the full thing, but I think our current understanding of string theory is probably too elementary. And it's a worthwhile problem that can show. And perhaps one of the surprises is that by thinking about this very abstract problem, you learn some things about ordinary problems.
Yes, that it could teach you. Yesterday.
Yeah, that's right. That it could teach you something about quantum field theory, about strongly interacting quantum systems, and so it didn't have to be this way. Maybe it was some esoteric theory, but it turns out this esoteric theory is very closely connected to ordinary physical theories. It's perhaps not surprising because actually string theory arose not from some esoteric thinking, but by trying to fit, you know, the strings that were observed in experiments, the strings of quantum chromodynamics. Uh-huh. So it's closely connected to physics. And,
In fact, the ADS CFT is an example because the CFT is a very close cousin in many of this ADS 5 example. Is a very close cousin of the quantum chromodynamics, which is sort of a glue that holds the nucleus together.
Yeah, that's
it's closely related to. It's not exactly quantum chromodynamics, but with some minor modification, it is closely related to theory of gravity. So I think there is that connection. But okay, but what are the criteria, sort of? I mean, if you were to, if a young graduate student is asking this question,
well, I think
what guides your.
Well, I think the criterion is that the
of the community, you know?
Of the community in general. It's. So I like to joke that the string sounds is an acronym that means solid theoretical research into natural geometric structures.
That's a very good one. That's a good joke.
And that's roughly the thinking of the community in the sense that, well, you can theorize how much you want, but it has to be at least mathematical. It has to be mathematically consistent. There has to be some solid formula. The formula might be have very narrow application, or it might only hold for some very special thing. But at least it has to be correct within, at least self-consistent.
Right.
If we use theorize so much that the formula even is not self-consistent, or there is no formula, then it's a little more suspect. And if it is sufficiently interesting, we can tolerate no formula. But and also some natural geometric structures. What does that mean? I mean, it's there are surprising thing about nature is that there are some theories that are very powerful, like quantum field theory that describes. Describes systems of interacting particles, describes the standard model with its incredible successes. And this is a structure that has lots of subtlety, and you can study it on its own. And much of the work in our field is actually understanding aspects of quantum field theory, even before trying to understand quantum gravity. And understanding those aspects will probably teach us something about quantum gravity, because any theory of quantum gravity has to recover quantum field theory and general properties of quantum field theory. And I called it geometric because, by special relativity, we know that, quantum field theory is the theory that puts together space-time, so the space-time of general special relativity and quantum mechanics together, and it does this successfully. And quantum gravity should do that, but with general relativity, put quantum mechanics and general relativity together. So it's only a first step. And general relativity is a theory of geometry, and geometry is very important. There are interesting geometries like black holes and cosmological geometries that they are still very confusing. They were very confusing classically, so it took 50 years to understand the Schwarzschild solution, simplest solution of Einstein's equations. It took 50 years to understand what the classical geometry was. Not even talking about
to detect it, the gravitational waves.
Right? Yeah, this is to I'm now talking about the theory. So just theoretically understanding what the geometry that the Schwarzschild solution describes took 50 years.
That's right.
Now, of course, it took took many more years to understand how to see black holes in nature. And whether black holes are or not present in nature. And now we have great evidence that they are present, but perhaps the most beautiful evidence is from the gravity wave detections that we had very recently, and and probably we'll understand those things better and better. But maybe there are other exotic objects that we haven't thought about and they're waiting to be discovered.
Yeah, I mean, I guess one comment I want to say is that, I mean, somehow when a common person says theory, you know, I think the physicists, when they mean theory, they really have some quite elaborate and very closely fitting structure in mind, like quantum field theory. Whereas for a common person, theory means, okay, I have a theory that it will rain today, or I have a theory that... So sometimes there is a...
Yeah, so the fact that the theories we make of physics have to be consistent with all previous experiments and all previous observations puts a huge constraint.
How huge that constraint is sometimes is not appreciated.
Yeah, yeah, it's a very, very big constraint. So the constraints also... Well, just the constraints of special relativity and quantum mechanics are very, very strong, and they lead to quantum field theory.
Antiparticles.
They lead to antiparticles and predictions of this kind. So, yeah, antiparticles is a general prediction of quantum field theory. They are theory independent in the sense that, they are present for electrodynamics, for chromodynamics, for,
So it just follows from the theoretical constraints of the theory.
Yeah, that's right. Follows very general. Very general. Okay.
So,
Another example is Hawking radiation.
Yes, that's a very
That's another example that just quantum field theory in the presence of horizons and so on predicts this thermal radiation. That's also a generic prediction of quantum field theory. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's a very close cousin of Hawking radiation where you don't have to talk about the black hole, which is to even be in flat space, and you are an accelerating observer in flat space, sometimes called Unruh radiation. So that accelerating observer would see a temperature. And that fact is also a very generic prediction of quantum field theory.
Yeah, also closely related is this primordial perturbations. I mean, the quantum fluctuations that...
Right. Yeah, galaxies. That's right. Yeah, and this... Maybe one could say, emphasize the fact that now, people sometimes say, okay, well, Hawking radiation, okay, hasn't been seen. People talk a lot about Hawking radiation. Why do you care about Hawking radiation? You can calculate it for astrophysical black holes, and it's very, very tiny. You'll never see it, at least in the black holes that have masses, or the solar masses, which are the ones that naturally form. So why do you study such a silly thing? So, but the point is that this effect is also... present during cosmology, as you were just saying.
Very closely.
And it's the same thing. The same thing. There is a cosmological horizon, and it's basically the same effect. And that effect is crucial for describing aspects of our universe. So the fact that the universe is not perfectly homogeneous, and it describes the long-distance structure of the universe very well. So it's not that this effect plays a central role in explaining how the universe is like it is. So,
mm-hmm. All the galaxies, why they are so not uniform, the structures that we observe, they somehow came from this very subtle quantum fluctuation, which you think is, why is it important? But it's actually all important.
It's
okay. So maybe I should ask you the final question I should ask you. So you've been talking, I guess your lectures, Salam lectures, are on sort of some of your recent work on quantum entanglement and space-time. It's a very beautiful connection between entanglement and quantum mechanics and geometry of space-time. Yeah, so maybe can you tell us a bit about what are the exciting future directions for your research or all these developments that you have been recently occupied with? Yeah, can you say something about that?
Well, I think... this relationship between entanglement and geometry is basically understanding how the basic quantum description of space-time builds the space-time. And part, you could say, is understanding how holography works. Part is to understand better the interior of black holes, because the interior to describe the interior of the black hole, this connection to entanglement seems crucial, and to solve black hole paradoxes and so on seems to be an important element, and we don't understand it well enough to solve all the paradoxes, but we do understand that it is important for thinking about the paradoxes. And So, for example, going back to the Schwarzschild solution, one aspect that was understood about the Schwarzschild solution is that it describes two black holes. And the idea is that these two black holes are dual to separate quantum systems, but they are in an entangled state. So that understanding more this connection seems to be interesting. And that's now where is it leading? So I think it's hopefully leading to a new picture of what space-time is, mm-hmm. And how space, the space-time and the quantum are related. Mm-hmm. Because it's interesting that you can have a connected space-time that comes from disconnected quantum systems, because it's saying that the local physical laws of that you see in this universe, which is some evolution law and so on, are somehow present in the patterns of entanglement of the quantum system. They are internal to that pattern, and how to think about this is what we are trying to understand.
Yeah, so they are sort of connected in this extra dimension. Even though the systems are far away from each other, there is this extra dimension that we talked about in the ABC system, and they're connected in that extra space-time dimension.
And this connection is has some interesting implications for quantum teleportation, which is a general quantum mechanical property of mm-hmm. systems, of entangled systems. And hopefully one will learn to use some of these ideas for cosmology in some way.
That's always in the back of your mind.
In the back of everybody's mind, how to apply some of these things to cosmology. There hasn't been a killer application, but
given the history of string theory,
applied. We've already seen an example, which was Hawking radiation, right? Discovered for black holes, then applied to cosmology.
Okay, it was really exciting and to hear. I mean, it was very. Thank you for a very nice pedagogical sort of introduction to your ideas and work, and it was great fun to talk to you.
Thank you.
I look forward
to be here. Yeah.